I'm the coordinator for the Master of Architecture program here at SUTD, and it's my great pleasure to welcome you here tonight. This is our last lecture of the term for our Master of Architecture lecture series, and I will be the moderator for today's discussion. I'd like to welcome our audience, our Master of Architecture students, our undergraduates, our distinguished alumni, our colleagues from the architecture community. It's wonderful to have you back at SUTD. We'd also like to welcome students from outside of SUTD, including JC and Poly students. The lecture series reinforces the centrality of sustainability in our curriculum. It positions our Master of Architecture students at the forefront of discourse on sustainable architecture. SUTD has been committed to sustainability since its founding. And our architecture students, our faculty, have achieved international recognition for their innovative, sustainable design. With this year's lecture series, Design Beyond Zero, we're focusing our attention on Singapore's Green Plan 2030. We're asking how designers can aim above and beyond the push for carbon neutrality to maximize vibrancy, productivity, and livability of our built environment. So given this theme, I'm incredibly thrilled to welcome tonight's very distinguished guest, Dr. Ken Yeang, the Executive Director of Hamza and Yeang. Architect Yeang is named as one of the 50 people who could save the planet. As an architect and ecologist, he is known for his signature hypergreen architecture, a field he has pioneered since 1971. His work has received very numerous awards, more than we can mention here tonight. The Aga Khan Award, the Prince Klaus Award from Netherlands, the Lan Si Qing International Award from China, the Merdeka Award from Malaysia, Malaysia Institute of Architects Gold Medal, and many others for work that performs beyond green rating systems. Projects include Susanna Putrajaya, the Genome Research Building in Hong Kong, Singapore's own National Library, the Great Ormond Street Children's Hospital Extension in UK, and many others. Architect Yeang has authored over 12 books on the principles of ecological and bioclimatic architecture. One of the most recent I have here, Saving the Planet by Design. This is a required reading for our master's students of architecture. It's been a great pleasure to meet the author for our students. As this is a very meaningful event, our head of pillar, Tai Li Xiang, will be sharing a few words of welcome for our esteemed guest. So please, just a quick round of applause for Tai Li Xiang.
Thanks, Peter. Before I so-called introduce my friend, just want to tell everyone that we have an up-and-coming event on the 9th of September called it's considered a fringe event of International Built Environment Week. It's a whole-day event where we will invite Institute of Higher Learning speakers, of course, from ourselves, as well as industry and also agencies to share on 5 key themes of research that we are embarking on. So do look out for that notice and register with us. So I was just thinking through how I should introduce Ken. I think there's no better way to just coincide my own life in terms of some of the high and low points in my architecture career study with three of his very well-known projects. First is actually the Roof House in 1985. I remember I just finished my internship coming into fourth year, and frankly, it sucks. I was at the point of deciding if I would even continue my architecture education. I must say that the house project was refreshing. It shows a way forward as to how we could rethink tropical architecture. Now, fast forward, another significant project of Ken, which is Menara Meseniaga in 1992. I finished my kind of my tour duty with URA in 1992 and deciding what should I do next. Again, it's a key milestone of deciding architecture or otherwise. So it was again refreshing to see the continued pursuit of what a climatic sensitive architecture could be at that time. So the rest is history. I've gone on to join the architecture profession. Now, the third project that I also found refreshing in 1998, which is the Guthrie Pavilion. You can see the progression of thoughts, experimentation, research into a higher resolution of what climatic sensitive architecture could be. In 1998, I just finished 1 year of social work, having finished my so-called the first 6-7 years with DP Architect, deciding again whether to pursue higher goals of architecture. Seeing that work again was an inspiration for me. So like everyone said, the rest is history. So I shouldn't really steal more time from Ken and pass this time over to Ken for your exciting speech. So let's put our hands together and welcome Ken.
It's working now. Okay, good. Well, thanks everyone for coming. It's very kind of you. I'm going to talk about the work I've been doing for the last few years. So it's basically based on my doctorate that I did at Cambridge University. After I left Cambridge, it became my life's agenda. And so this is what I'm going to talk about, which is ecology-based design. I'm going to chat about the principles, some design and built examples. For me, everything starts with the biosphere, with the planet Earth. And people talk about sustainable design. Sustainable design has to relate to the planet Earth because that's the baseline for everything that we humans do. So if you negate the planet Earth and everything that you do in relation to it, then you're negating sustainable design. So the health of the planet then becomes crucial to me and is exactly the sort of thing that we should all be worried about, because saving the planet, you cannot justify it commercially. We do it because it is an ethical thing to do, it's the right thing to do. So the Earth is covered by this thin film called the biosphere, which is about 12 meters in height. And this is where all living organisms live. Within the biosphere are units in nature called ecosystems. Ecosystems consist of communities of plants and animals acting together as to form a whole, as a system. Now, for those of you who have an ecological background, this is pretty kid stuff, but I thought I'll just use this as the start. Now, the ecosystem consists of biotic communities, plants, animals, and the physical environment, abiotic. But we as human beings is part of the biotic constituents. But we're different. We're the most powerful of all species. And we can change landscapes, we can change waterways, we can pollute the seas. And so we make things. I call this the built environment because it covers everything that we make. And we make more things than any other species in nature. And these things, we use them in a throughput fashion. We use it, we don't want to throw it away. But in the planet, there's no way. Everything stays here. And so, the planet is increasingly devastated. But by the things that we do, we clear the land, we chop down trees, we pollute the air. We pollute the water. So now, the basis of my thesis is what happens if we're able to biintegrate our built environment, everything that we make with the natural environment, in a seamless and benign way. So that was the challenge that I gave to myself. And I said, this can only work if our buildings and our built environment and everything that we make are like nature. And so I started to look at what are called, people call it biomimicry, I call it eco-mimicry. That means we emulate, replicate, and augment the properties of ecosystems in our built environment. Now, that is the biggest challenge. That is the big idea I want to put in your heads today. And I'll start looking into attributes of the ecosystem. On the right-hand side are the list of attributes that we need to emulate. Now, this is easier said than done. It is extremely difficult, and I've been struggling with this to some extent, with some success, with a lot of failures. And so this is the list of attributes we need to emulate. The first one is biological structure. Because as I mentioned, you know, nature consists of abiotic constituents. But our built environment is almost physical, just like this room that you're in. Everything in this room is inorganic except you and me and the bugs and the bacteria. So we should try to emulate, to make the buildings like ecosystems. We have to bring back the attributes and properties of the ecosystem. So I started to think about how can we bring landscaping, bring the biotic constituents back into the built environment. So a few years back, I started to prepare this diagram, which has been expanded a little bit, where you can put all the, you know, the biotic constituents in one location as the first diagram, or you have a spotty relationship as in the second diagram, or you have a stepping stone relationship, which is not going to link, or you can have a tree relationship, as you see in the fourth diagram. But the ideal relationship is where the vegetation is connected, it is linked and starts from the ground, and that by being linked, it enables a larger pool of natural resources to be shared among the species and generates a much more stable ecosystem within the built environment. And so the last diagram is, if you like, you know, my golden chalice, which I'm trying to imitate in the work that we do. And so we started to do this back in 1985. This is the building that we did, where we put, you know, this is a spotty relationship where we had vegetation in patches throughout the whole building. It's not ideal, but it was a start, you know. And then at the same time while looking at this, I started looking into the idea of a passive low energy building. And I started to look into what I call net zero energy design. On the left-hand side, there are a series of steps of stages for net zero energy. I'm not going to go through that today. It will bore you to tears. But it's basically this wedge diagram where you optimize passive mode, you optimize mixed mode, you have the most efficient and a smart full mode, and then the last step is the productive mode where you use and generate your own energy. So with the Bausted building, which is the one that you saw earlier on, I started to look at how I can make the tall building into a low passive, low energy building. And so one of the things that I learned was that, you know, is that by putting the core position in the right location on the east and west side, you start with a low energy passive mode building. So you can see on the left side, this is a diagram of different core position, different orientation, different configuration. And that the one in red shows the lowest energy configuration. So that was the basis for my design in Boston building. You can see the core on the left side, the core on the right side. But all the staircases, the toilets, the lift lobby have natural ventilation opportunity. They're not natural ventilated, you can open the window. But what it means is if you have natural ventilation opportunity, you don't need to pressurize it, so it's not a high energy building. So the next thing I started to look at is biodiversity. Now, biodiversity varies depending on what latitude you're in, what climatic zone you're in. But this is a useful quick indicator that shows that different latitudes have different extent of biodiversity. And of course, you know, you're in Singapore, we are in Singapore now, and at the equator, we have the highest level of biodiversity. So then how do we translate this? How do you interpret this into design? So the idea that I had then was to make the building into a constructed ecosystem, we have to create habitats within the building. The habitats could be on the walls, could be on the terraces, could be within the buildings, could be on the roofs, could be on the ground. You know, so that's the challenge. So we started to work with ecologists and we developed what we call a biodiversity targets matrix. The first thing we do is to create habitats, as I mentioned. You know, for this project, these are different habitats that we have on the ground, the walls and so forth. And that's the plan of the building. The next then is to choose, select, do research on the faunal species that we have been left, we have to remove from the site to bring back to the site. So on the first axis on the left-hand side are the faunal species. The next is to find the flora species that will attract the faunal species. Then we look at this, how does it interact with the particular habitat depending on its location. From there, we use this as a basis for designing the landscape system. So in this way, we the building that is almost totally abiotic, inorganic, physical, we try to make it into a living system. So this was the approach that we did. And this was the building that was finished in 2017. And it is along the axis leading to the Millennium Monument by the waterfront, which was also designed by us about 10 years earlier. And it starts from the plaza, as you can see on the right-hand side. This is the promenade in between the two blocks. There's the height restriction, there's the volume restriction, so I had to work within that. And it's right next to the bridge that the authorities are very keen over. And this is built in Putrajaya, which is the new capital city of Malaysia. And on the right-hand side is the access that leads to the Prime Minister's office, which is at the bottom of the boulevard. We wanted to make this into a prime, aesthetically refined building. So we took the gem, the diamond, as a metaphor for faceting the facade. And so then we, of course, we faceted by slicing it and cutting, punching holes in it where the planted terraces. And then we put a white fritted pattern on the glass, which is a songket pattern, which is a Malay pattern, fabric pattern, so that the cultural identity is there. But the glass isn't butt jointed, it's separated by gaps, so it's naturally ventilated. But between the outside skin and inside skin, there is a service walkway. The third image shows what it looks like from the outside, looking into the glass wall. It's an experimental form of sunshading, and that the last image is the inside looking out. And you can see up, it's not totally excluded exterior. And then the building then becomes a signifier of the location. So on the west side, we angled the facade to keep it, to protect from the western sun. And that here it is, the two axes, the axis leading to the Prime Minister's office, and the other one is the axis leading to the waterfront. And the waterfront, you can see the monument on the left-hand side, which is the monument. They called it the Millennium Monument, and we had the history of the country, map onto the facade of the monument. And that was one of our nicest projects. Then the monument is shaped based on the analogy with the hibiscus flower, because hibiscus is the national flower in Malaysia. And so it's like a petals with a stamen on the middle. And that was the project. The head of Putrajaya at that time was Tan Sri Azizan. I taught him from a bar of soap, and when I made presentation, he called me Dr. Yeang. But halfway through, he called me Ken. I said, "Well, that's good news. I've got the project." Anyway, that was Putrajaya for you. The average office building in Malaysia uses about 250 something kilowatt hours per square meter per annum, which is the energy efficiency index. But with this as an experimental sunshade, it uses about 138, so about 70% less. Now, I thought this was a great achievement until I met somebody 2 days ago who said they got 9 kilowatt hours per square meter per annum, which is something that now I have to compete. And we had a number of experimental devices. One of them is what we call the eco cell, where we had a continuous landscaping going all the way down to the lower floors. And so the eco cell, you can see on the left hand side, here just going down with the ramps. And eco cell was an idea we developed maybe about 10, 12 years earlier, the top image is our competition scheme for the Kowloon waterfront. We didn't win a competition, but we got an honorary mention. But that's a whole different story altogether. And so the EcoCell does a number of things. It brings vegetation down to the basement, brings daylight down to the lowest level, brings opportunities for rainwater harvest, natural ventilation, rainwater harvesting at the bottom of the EcoCell. We could put John Todd's living machine or a bass whale. So now then, how do we do this with a vertical building? And so this is a building which is now under construction. We call it the Tree of Life. And we put a green wall, climb all the way up to the top. And off the green wall, we have branches that goes up into sky courts, where the vegetation extends. And so this is back to this diagram again of the green wall and the green spaces. And these are different sky courts. So we start by looking at the ecology surrounding the site. And so the first first map shows the site, which is the red dot and the green areas, the lake gardens and the other gardens on the right-hand side. And then we look at the green areas in the proximity of the site to identify what species of fauna that we want to bring back, which are not hazardous human beings, what flora species that are non-invasive at that particular location that will attract the fauna species. So from there we thought, okay, if it's vertical, then we bring butterflies, dragonflies, birds, and large birds, to the locality, because that's the only species that can reach the upper parts of a high-rise building. And so this is, if you like, the beginning of the biodiversity matrix. And this is the actual matrix itself. And so this became the matrix that becomes the guide for us to identify which flora species are used for landscaping. And the top roof deck is for entertainment. We have we have four pools. We have the lab pool, we have the family pool, we have the children's pool, and we have the jacuzzi pool. So it's a real fun area at the top of the building. And you can see the sky courts on the floor below. So then next we look into continuity, because in nature everything is continuous, almost continuous, but most instances are continuous. And so we start to look at patterns again. And the pattern would be, when we design, we should try making continuous on the ground plane, then bring it up the building. And so the whole idea that then all of a sudden the whole city becomes linked. The whole city becomes a green city, where the vegetation and the species are linked, they have shared resources in this linked city. So people ask me, what do you do? How do you make a city green? I said, well, the first thing you need to do is look at the green areas. It's not just planting individual trees all over the place. Link your green areas. Make them continuous. Enable the species to migrate and species to interact, and species to clamp into buildings, so then the whole city becomes an ecosystem, becomes what I call a human-made ecosystem. And so this was the building that we did in One North, and what they call the Solaris building. So this time we had a ramp going all the way around the facade of the building. And this is the ground floor plan for a competition we did in Waterloo Road, which we didn't win. But this was the Edith Tower. And that's the ground floor plan. You can see the ramp on the outside. There were faults in this design because people say, oh, how do you service the vegetation? So from there, we said, okay, we'll find some way to do it. And then the idea was that using the building as the motivator, whenever the vegetation reaches the roof level of the adjoining buildings, you bridge across and you green the roofs of the building, so the building then greens, becomes something that greened the whole city. Of course, this is an idea was never implemented. And so that's what's trying to do. So this is the vegetation that goes across. And so with Solaris, we had a ramp going all the way up around the building and with every floor, the ramp climbs one floor. And so this was the This was the inspirational drawing that we did. So this time we put a walkway next to the greenery so you could service the greenery without going through the usable user spaces. And so this was the improvement on the earlier design. And that we did this, and then sure enough, you know, it took us a while. It took about 8 years from the Edith Tower to getting this building built. So as I tell people, you know, many years, being an architect's an old man's game, you're not going to get everything built straight away. It takes a while, you know, to get, you know, your ideas built. And so this is another part of the facade with the green ramp. And we have green terraces. And the earlier drawing that I did was, the idea was to have ecological corridor on the periphery and ecological fingers going into the urban area. And so this is, the one is the map of Manhattan, showing an idea how, you know, before the apocalypse comes, we could green Manhattan. These are one of the eco bridges you can see. And that, so this is a building seen from a distance. On the far left is the building done by the famous Japanese architect, Kisho Kurokawa, who's my friend. And he died about 4 years ago. And these are the green ramps. When it hits the corner of the building, it opens up into what I call a green terrace. So these, like, you know, these are, I call them, we call them little pocket parks. And the whole linear ramp becomes what I call the linear park, climbing out the facade of the building. And this is the corner ramp. We did a design that was implemented by CPG, right? Very nicely, you know, implemented. On the right hand side is the building working on London, where it was his alternating sky courts. Now, the building has a number of experiments. One of the experiments was that we want to make a low energy building, so the atrium is not air conditioned. It has a glass roof on top, which is operable and to keep out the rain, but on the most normal days it's open. And that we just have cold air blown into the space, so it is not fully air conditioned. And then this is the uppermost, the glass roof, the skylight, which on a normal, when it rains, it just shuts. But then if it's on a normal day, it opens out and lets the hot air out. And so this is operable roof. So that was the first experiment we had, and this is the bridge that links the two halves of the project with the atrium in between. And then this is the natural ventilation wall on the side. One of the experiments we had is what we call a diagonal light shaft that brings daylight to the inner parts of the building. So here's a diagonal shaft cutting across the building. The diagonal shaft is actually just a small slot like that. And on the right-hand side is the analysis of the daylight penetration of the building. So you can see I have a deep plan, so it's not perfect. You know, I should have done a narrow floor plate. This is looking down the diagonal shaft in the street. So there's a visual connectivity between the upper parts of the building and the lower parts of the building, and there's the bottom looking up. And so that's the idea of a circulating diagram, a walkway, and this is the eco cell for this particular building at the eastern corner of the site. And this is the view from the south. The energy consumption of the building, no, this is the vegetation index, I think. It's about, I can't read it, but it's you know, fairly low, it's about 6 point something. And this is the mid-level roof. So you can see the roof plan on the roof, the green roof on the left-hand side. And then on the, and this is the uppermost roof. This is another garden, which is, it has a terrific view, gives a terrific view of the Novena area. And so the project has been pleasurable project for us. Now then the next property that we need to emulate and replicate is provision of ecosystem services. So what you see in that blue patch are the ecosystem services that nature does for us without human intervention. And this was started to be tabulated in the year 2000 by ecologists and naturalists. And it's extremely difficult to emulate this because nature produces oxygen, produces energy by photosynthesis. Nature sequests the pollution from the air. But absolutely no way that we can imitate this 100%. And so this is the big challenge in what we're trying to do, really, to replicate, to, you know, to provision ecosystem services. And so I started to think, well, as they say, you can't beat them, but join them. So I thought, what we need to do is to integrate nature with the built environment. And the idea was to have a series of fingers of nature, urban fingers, woven, you know, next to each other, cheek by jowl. And so this is a master plan we did for a site in La Reunion, which is an island east of Madagascar, where we have, you can see the urban fingers, and then you have the green fingers, and we have a corridor by the waterfront that collects all the species, which then brings it into the water. And so in this way, the green areas provide the ecosystem services in close proximity to the urban areas. It's not like London, where Hyde Park is miles away from the East End, or, you know, Regent's Park is, you know, miles away from Hackney, you know. So, you know, by bringing it in close proximity, then you're able to produce the ecosystem services. So the idea was to have urban fingers on the left-hand side going into the city, into the built environment, and the right-hand side is the built environment going out into the waterfront. And we estimate, we calculate this, but, you know, the urban area should be about 50 meters. A green area would be 20 meters. And so this is, if you like, an idea for the project. But then we have roads cutting across, but you cannot bifurcate the green fingers. And so we need to find out a device for doing this. So this is the green coming from the waterfront. This is the green going down. And so the idea was what I call the eco-undercroft. That means the road goes, the green areas goes underneath the road. It's continuous going underneath the road. So it's an eco-undercroft. That was the scheme. And then the edges should not be pristine. They should be jagged. It could be irregular so that species can find places to hide, find places to breed. And so this is the shape, and then this is the overall master plan. The third one is one of these factors that we're trying to emulate is biointegration. How to integrate all the key factors in ecological design together into a whole. So the key factors to me are five factors. First one is nature. Second is human society. Third is water. And fourth is energy. And fifth is, can I read my own writing? Energy, structure, the built environment, which is the fourth. And energy is the fifth. And so this is a master plan that we did in Bangalore. It's right next to the forest reserve. So the first thing we did, obvious thing to do, was to collect all the species at the edge between our site and the waterfront and the forest reserve. And we stretch it across like a piece of chewing gum over the site and right to the edge of the site so you can join to a joint site. So it becomes, if you like, a motivator to make other sites green as well. And if you like, this is the green pattern going from the green corridor across the site to the other sites. Now this is the road that cuts the green corridor. Once you do this, then hang about. You've cut the green corridors. So we have come up with an idea equivalent to the green undercroft. It's what we call the eco bridge. So this way, the road goes underneath the bridge, and the green is continuous across the site. Here's another view of the eco bridge. That links all the vegetation together. So then the whole site becomes a linked, a unified ecosystem, you know, with species being able to move from one part of the site to the other part of the site. And it's not bifurcated like the way most cities are done. Because, you know, human beings tend to fragment nature, mix. You know, human loves doing this. They convert burgers, the cow into a burger, you know. And so this is an idea that we try to do, and these are the five basic factors: nature, human society, hydrology, built environment and structures and technology, and energy systems. So the next then was to see how we can bring the water that hits on the ground, stays back in the ground, because what happens now is that the water hits the ground, goes into impervious surfaces, goes into drains, goes to rivers, and it's gone forever. So we need to bring it back to the ground to recharge the groundwater so that it retains and it enhances the soil in other aspects. And then for the black water, we have constructed wetland like this, so the water goes through a series of cleansing ponds, so by the time it reaches the last pond, it is almost potable. Not exactly almost potable. So this, if you like, a biointegration of these four factors mapped into one single drawing. But again, this is a physical biointegration. Ideally, it has to be systemic biointegration, which I haven't been able to achieve yet. Next would be climate, because different ecosystems, you know, different under climate condition, you have a different type of ecosystem. So we have to respond to the climate of the place. And this, if you like, is my diagram for designing the low energy building. You start from optimizing passive mode, the second optimizing mixed mode, which is partial energy systems. You start to have smart systems, you know, and efficient systems for full mode. And then productive mode is the last one, which is what you try and do to use renewable sources of energy, but not fossil fuels. I mean, this is, if you like, a diagram. Achieve net zero energy is an impossibility because, you know, you can achieve in absolute terms, but you can get as near as you can. And I don't have time to go through this today, but these are different stages and are different levels of temperature, comfort conditions from external to passive mode, to mixed mode, to productive mode, and finally full mode, which is the red color in the middle. So then we start to look at how do we apply this into a building. And so this is a building that we did back in 1985. Where we said, okay, you know, we should do buildings like umbrella. And that, the umbrella building is my golden chalice because it's cybernetic. You can adjust it depending on the direction of wind and the rain and whatever climatic factors. You just tilt the umbrella and angle it. And it functions, you know, in that way. So the first idea that we had for this building done in 1985 is the idea of umbrella as a louvered roof. So here it is. This was done and it was built in complete 1985. And this is the louvered that's in the morning sun, keeps out the midday sun, and keeps out the afternoon sun. And this is the floor plan with ventilation spaces going through the middle. And this is the ventilating space from the end of the house. And then the walls are angled not exactly 90 degrees to the side, so that you can, you know, you blurs the inside with the outside. So the inside and the outside also becomes a courtyard to the inside, and without strict definition. And so, again, you know, we look into the energy consumption. The building uses about, 60-something kilowatt hours per square meter per annum compared to most houses, which are about 80. This is another canopy over a guard house. The canopy then doubles as a communal spaces. There's a canopy over a railway station. There's a canopy. Well, this time the fritted glass that we used in the Solaris building, I mean in the Putrajaya building, we put it horizontally. So it's like a sun shading which is horizontal over the university hub of the University of Malaya. Here it is, which is the canopy. And this is a station we designed where the whole station is made out of small modules clipped together. And so, you know, optimizing passive mode, mixed mode, full mode, productive mode, you know, is the procedure to do net zero energy. And this is a building we did in London, which is the Great Ormond Street Children's Hospital Extension. And the whole idea was to see in a cold, temperate climate, you have a very cold winter and a very hot summer, but you have two very nice seasons, you know, mid-seasons, which is spring and autumn. And we try and extend the mid-seasons as much as possible into the summer, so you reduce the need for air conditioning, into the winter, so you reduce the need for heating. And by doing so, it becomes a low-energy building. And this building has this flue that we put on the outside, so it brings natural ventilation to the lower three floors, which is occupied by Walt Disney. And you can see the valve at the bottom floor and the valve at the top of the flue. This is another building we did in Beijing in a cold climate, which is not completed. And this time we created, again, the same idea of extending the mid-seasons, and that for a productive mode, the idea that the building itself becomes a power plant. So this is a building that we designed where we have embedded photovoltaics embedded into the glass of the building to increase the energy efficiency. This is a data center we are working on now, and for the background areas to be independent of the grid, it has to be at least, the photovoltaics area has to be at least 60% of the GFA. But of course, you know, the machines themselves, you know, are energy, so we have to make sure that find ways to address machine, the energy from machines. This is just a structural diagram that shows how we work. We do research, then we derive generic concepts and principles. We interpret by design, then we get it built and as prototyping. And then we evaluate, discover ideas and advance the principles. We do feedback, we publish it, and then we repeat the whole process again. So this is what we've been doing for the last 5 decades of practice. Research, generic principles, interpret by design, build, evaluate and discover, publish, and get feedback. Now this is again sort of very simplistic, but at each of the stages we have to derive the metrics with, you know, the quantification aspects of it. So now I'm going to end in a minute. What are the principles we presented today? The first one is that I call ecocentricity, where designing based on the science of ecology. And the next one is eco-mimicry, where we remake the built environment, which is a huge task. I don't know whether it'd be achievable in my lifetime, provided we subscribe to it, as human-made ecosystems or construct ecosystems by replicating and emulating ecosystem attributes. Thank you.
A big thank you to our audience. Thank you for your attention. Are there some questions from our students, ideally, as well, for Dr. Yeang out there?
Well, I'm very glad that my good friend and nemesis, Taking Soon, is not here. He makes sushi. He chopped me up into sushi. Okay. He's my friend. But, you know, like every organism, if you're an ecologist, you learn that there's good positive feedback and negative feedback. If you just take in positive feedback, the organism will die. But if you take in negative feedback, the organism adapts, it changes, it evolves. And so it's always good to get negative feedback. You know, one day I was, I like telling stories. I was chairing a meeting of a case of architects in Thailand. There were Siamese architects, Indonesian architects, Taiwanese architects, architects from all over Asia. And we're all about the same level. Well, except for one architect, is Mr. Maki. Mr. Maki is a Pulitzer Prize winner, and he's there, we're all here. Now, the Korean architect is Dr. Lee, who was usually a very ebullient and lively person, but that particular day, sitting around the table, he was very serious. He said to Maki, "What do you think of Korean architecture?" And I thought, oh dear, we have a minefield here, you know? Step on a mine and get your leg blown off. So Maki, the wise man that he is, he says, doesn't matter what I think. You have to be your own worst critic. What I mean by your own worst critic is that people praise you you don't get vacated because you know, if you criticize yourself worse than anybody else. And if you're your own worst critic, people criticize you, you don't get hurt because you're your own worst critic. So that diffuses the whole thing. So I'm happy to listen to what you guys say, you know, criticize, do your worst. If I survive King Sun, I could survive anything. So I'm only joking. I invited King Sun to come and he said, you got a difference in ecology and philosophy. You know, one day we were flying from Beijing to Singapore and there was a fault in the plane, you know. And so King Sun and I were stuck in the business class lounge in Hong Kong airport. So we sat down and not to waste time, said, King Sun, let's chat about architecture. And King Sun says, you and I would never agree. I said, do you even disagree with all topics? You and I would never agree. So, not giving up, I suggested a piece of writing. And I said, what do you think of this piece of writing? And King Sun said, read between the lines. So I thought, read between the lines means there's an alternative meeting. I said, could it be mean this and this, King Sun? He said, no, read between the lines. So we went for a while, and I said, King Sun, I give up. I can't read between the lines. He said, look, between the lines, there's white space, there's nothing there. Never mind. Yes, sure. Go ahead.
Okay, is this a question here? Sorry, the microphones. If you do have a question, you can step up and walk to the microphone or raise your hand. We did have a discussion earlier. We had a workshop with our Master of Architecture students. We had a discussion with a student, Nick. We were talking about happiness, the importance of architecture to elevate the human spirit, to bring us happiness. And we were talking with Eva Castro as well, who raised the point, because of all of the problems that we experience with our environment, the degradation of the environment, is there also a place for protest in architecture? I thought this was an interesting point. That we could open this discussion with as well, right?
All right, yes. So do you want me to answer that? Or?
Okay, yes.
What was the question again?
Architecture should elevate the human spirit.
Yes.
At the same time, is there not a responsibility for ecological architecture to raise awareness of problems with the environment?
Oh, yes, absolutely. But as I tell people, let's say in the future we get everything right, all the systems right, planning is right, and we have a green world. But what happens if we as human beings don't behave ourselves? We pollute the ground, we pollute the environment. And so everything depends on us as human beings. Green design is not green, the green world is not kind of green design, not green technology, not building commodity. It depends on you as a person. Now, how many people believe in this? How many people actually practice this? How many architects do that? And so, in many ways, I find it extremely difficult to talk to people of my generation because they don't have an ecological background. Now, if I can't even talk to my own profession, how can I talk to other people? So, you know, it's an uphill climb.
Another theme that we're talking about in the Design Beyond Zero lecture series is how green architecture, how net zero energy, net zero waste, net zero carbon architecture can go beyond and also serve the community via civic architecture. A great example of that is the National Library building. It has a wonderful public space at the ground level. I recently went there and enjoyed a cup of tea during a rainstorm. It was incredibly pleasant to sit there. It was a great way to interact with other people from the city. So in a way, by being bioclimatic architecture, by being responsive to the climate, it's also a civic space, a space that invites people to come together. That synergy is wonderful in your work.
Thank you. I wonder
if you could share with us how you achieve that.
Well, the National Library was won in a competition. At that time, the government selects architects through competition. They advertise in newspapers. There were 65 responses. They shortlisted 5 people to do the competition, including Michael Graves, Australian architect, Deakin Seke, and a few others. So one of the things we did was almost blasphemous for commercial buildings, that we freed the whole ground plane for a plaza. You know, if you look at the ground plane, a good part of it is a plaza. And we call it a cultural plaza because cultural activities take place there. You know, one of the requirements of the competition was that you had to design the cultural building. Now, a cultural building is not, Chinese roofs, tweakends, and you know, motifs. But the lifestyle of the people, if the people live there and they use it as a cultural space, then it becomes a cultural building. So that's the basis for that design. Talking about green design, you know, you all know the famous Chinese architect Ian Pei, who did the Raffles City, you know. And so he got the RIBA gold medal. And Ian Pei was the generation between him and me is, you know, several decades. And so I took him out for dinner at a restaurant in Mayfair called Prince's Garden. And then, you know, as we talk about this, his wife came over and says, "Oh, you know, he's 83 years old." I said, "Yes, good, you know, thank you." Then Ian Pei eventually looked at me and says, "What do you do? What sort of architecture do you do?" I said, "Mr. Pei, I do green architecture." He didn't understand what it was. He says, "What is green architecture?" I said, "Oh, dear, I'm not going to explain green architecture to him over dinner." So I said, "Two coats of green paint." So he said, "Oh, I understand."
Great. We have a question up here in the first row.
Hello, Ken. Thank you for inviting me. My name is Tay Keng Soon. Yeah, I couldn't hear you very well just now, but I vaguely heard you mention my name. So I'm now compelled to respond to you.
Okay. Keng Soon, you're my nemesis.
Yes, I think rightly so. You remember we had a discussion some time ago, I think it was in the National Library. And of course, I criticized your work and your thinking because I felt that it was really pandering to the building industry very cleverly, of course, because you have been very, very effective in marketing your ideas, your pseudoscience ideas. And I said to you what I said, and you replied to me saying that, "But don't you think a gesture is important?" To which I replied, "Of course, a gesture towards green architecture is better than no gesture at all." But that is the issue, you see. In your last slide, where you had this circular diagram of describing your practice, how you come from with ideas, and then you practice, and then you get feedback, and then you improve, and so on. I have to say that that is a very normal kind of a diagram, because it does not question the economic and real estate context in which you function, and you function very well, because you are a superb marketeer. And I think that will inspire many young architects who want to emulate you to be successful in practice. But let me say something, that I think the world has reached a certain kind of crisis moment in which the question that is posed is not just about building better buildings and putting potted plants all over the building. It is about what is the role that architecture and urban planning must contribute to the making of a new civilizational order in which the human civilization does not come into military conflict, nor does it destroy planet Earth. And how do human beings live together in buildings and cities and neighborhoods so that they become intelligent and moral in the process of going about the routines of their everyday life? For example, we should never have single function buildings like the ones you design, an office building. An office building that is purely for as a workplace is a criminal act in the world of, in the new world that we need to create. We need multifunction, contiguous functions in which people, as they go about the routines of their everyday life, become intelligent, become empathetic, learn from each other, and develop a new culture. So what does your model of green architecture have to say about this? I think it says very little.
Well, that's a body of knowledge on green design, and I'm trying to extend it. And that's the purpose of what I do. Of course, I try and do it as an architect. And you know, when you go to school, when you talk to educationalists, they talk about the three R's that you teach people: reading, writing, and arithmetic, the three R's. And I tell them that's the fourth R. So they ask, what's the fourth R? The fourth R is architecture. Anyway, that's the fourth R. But you know, I am, my work is, has a theoretical base. I'm trying to develop, evolve it. I don't talk rubbish like Norway and paranoia, you know, all sorts of things like that, which is pseudo philosophy. What do you think about that? That's what you are best at. You talk about pseudo philosophy, whereas there's no formal theoretical academic basis for it. It benefits nobody except yourself. So this is what I think about what you said.
You are absolutely wrong. Yeah. I think that, first of all, I think there is a generational growth in all human beings. At our age, your age and my age, we should be going beyond the things that we were obsessed with when we were teenagers, right? And young adults, trying to make a way in the world, still trying to build a building, trying to get clients to see it our way and get our buildings built and published and get famous. All that is over. At our age, we must be thinking much deeper and much bigger, you know? So I think I feel sorry for you that at your age, you are still trying to be a teenager. This is ridiculous. I think that at our age, we have to address fundamental human issues. In your green diagram, the human being is not even there.
It isn't there, actually.
It's not there at all.
One of the five factors. Anyway, back to what you said. You know, you have to speak for yourself. At your age, you know, entropy may have set in. But to me, my brain is still working. I'm still developing new ideas. And I am researching, and I'm trying to advance the field. To me, that is more important than anything else. You know, we don't just do architecture. We innovate. Innovation is not just in design, not just in devices, not in the systems, but in the process as well. So we try and innovate, you know, how to design better, how to deliver buildings better. And the way we do things today is very different from what we did, you know, 50 years ago when I first started business. And to sustain a business over 47 years, which we've been business, it's extremely difficult. We've been through six recessions, And each recession, we just learn, adapt, and change, and develop. You know, so that is what we're trying to do. It's not easy. You know, as those of you who have children would have, you know, should have watched Sesame Street with them. In Sesame Street, there's a frog called Kermit. And what's the song that Kermit sings? It's not easy being green. So that's my view. But, you know, if you're old age, you're fossilized and you want to do things, you know, that's a battle I don't want to fight. I want to develop, you know, the theory of ecological design. I want to advance it. I want to make it meaningful and beneficial to humanity. You know, of course, that's the other option is, you know, when I first started practice in 1976, I had a cousin who's very close to me. His name is Gary, lives in Singapore. And Gary's very close to my mother, and you come to KL once in a while, and we would talk over dinner until 2-3 o'clock in the morning. So he would say to me, Ken, I hear you started a business as an architect. How are you getting on? I said, Gary, if you start business, you're getting from your friends and your relatives. After a while, I run out of friends and relatives. They don't want to see me anymore. He says, you've done a house, done a renovation, done an extension, you know, done a doghouse, you know, semi-detached doghouse, you know, but nothing for you. So I said, Gary, what do I do? So Gary says, you have to learn marketing. So where do I learn marketing? So I went to the Singapore Institute of Management, Malay Institute of Management. I did, you know, 3 courses in marketing, which was quite good because the people that I met at the courses, actually someone of them become my clients. And so a few, you know, months pass, and, you know, we meet up Gary again for dinner. And he said to me, Ken, how are you doing? I said, marketing okay? I said, marketing fine. I applied it and, you know, achieve a reasonable level of success. Then he said, what's your issue? I said, Gary, I can't manage. You know, you've got a few projects I can't manage. So Gary says, go back to business school, learn management. So I went back to business school. This time it wasn't 3-4 weeks, it was 6 months courses, evening courses. And so, you know, I learned marketing and management. A few months later, I met Gary again. Gary says, marketing going okay? Marketing is fine, Gary. Managing okay? I said, managing fine. What's your issue? I said, Gary, I'm not making money. So I said, go back to learn finance, learn income tax, learn cost control, you know. So I went back to Malay Institute of Management and the Malay Institute of Management and learned, you know, finance. And so a few months later, and this is the line that you should listen to, Gary says, marketing okay? Marketing's fine, developing. Management okay? Management okay. Finance okay? Yeah, I'm making some money, Gary. Not an awful lot, but I'm making some money. What's your issue? I said, Gary, I'm not happy. He said, go back to church. So that is the ultimate, because, you know, as you know, life doesn't last forever. You know, I was on the plane with a doctor. I was on the plane and sitting next to me is an Indian doctor. And we started to talk about, you know, life in general. And I said, what do you do? He says, I'm a doctor. I've now moved, I'm a Malaysian, but I went to live in Melbourne. And I've started a surgery. I said, start surgery, you're a doctor. You're no longer a doctor, you're a businessman. So then obviously went to other things. I said, you know, I checked with the internet. The average lifespan of a Malaysian is 72 years. I said, I'm 75 now. So, you know, I've gone beyond my shelf life. He says, no. He says, you know, middle class people, you know, 72 is for the working class and normal person, but for middle class, you know, it's 85. So I said, oh, I've got another 85 for Kingston to kick me around. You know. Only joking, Kingston. But Kingston, to be honest with you, is my worst critic. And every time he says something, it registers my head. I learn and improve and I develop and advance. I don't always take his advice. I don't always take his thinking. But it is, you have to take the positive with the negative. You evaluate yourself, you know. So back to this diagram. What I'm trying to do now is to get the metrics of what I do. That means able to quantify, You find out, for instance, there are five factors of my design. That's nature, ecology, that's human society and well-being. There is the built environment, technology and artifacts and semi-artificial artifacts. There is energy and there's water. So we need to quantify it. Then once we quantify it, it becomes a basis for evolving and development. Now that's easier said than done, because in trying to quantify what you do, it's a huge effort. We don't get paid for doing it. Nobody in the office wants to do it. Sometimes you have to beg the people to do it for you, or get my office to do it for you. And so this is, this is something you do. Now, if you hop back to 1994, 95, we were trying to get people to study the embodied energy of our buildings. We couldn't get anybody to do it. Finally, we found, a quantity surveying company, it's a very large quantity surveying company. They, because the quantity surveying, they know the quantity of these materials, they can do embodied energy calculation. This was back in 1990. But now everybody does embodied energy, or CFD analysis. We're doing an interior design for a shopping mall. A client says, I want a third of it to be non-air conditioned. And so I said, well, the answer is to use mixed mode, use a composite of mix of ceiling fans and cold air being blown in that space, and you have to use different types of fans with different types of configuration. But then the client says, I want to know the temperature. He wants to know the comfort condition inside a particular space. I said, the only way to do this is to get a CFD analysis done, computational fluid dynamics done. Those of you who are engineers will know what it is. Now, CFD is a very onerous process, and you cannot do it for the entire retail. You can do it for parts of different ages. Now, back in 1990, when I got RCF to be done, I couldn't find anybody to do it. The only person I could do was Chris Jones, a professor at Cardiff University. But now, they have standard models for doing CFD. They have even arrows to show that the airflow through that space. So things are much more sophisticated now. Going back to my cousin Gary told me, I think his son is in the audience, who is an AA graduate. Marketing back in 1976 is very different marketing today. And to be frank with you, I am what I am today because I go to business school. I don't just sit here and do bugger all, and contemplate my belly. So I went to courses in money industry management. I went to courses in single industry management. I even attended 1 week course at Harvard Business School, to learn the latest in management. So the management we do, the marketing we learned back in 1976, the principles are there. Today, the principles are the same, but the method is different. Today, it is used technology. We use search engine optimization. We use social, SMO, which is social media optimization. We use mass mailing. We use all sorts of new devices that didn't even exist back in 1990. So we're learning new things. We're developing and advancing. Now, why do I do this? I want to do this so I can keep my business going. It's not easy, to do business, but nobody pays for you to do the research on green building. But I have to do it on my own because I believe in it. I believe in doing a green building, not because, I want to do this or do that, because it's an ethical thing for us to do. We all have to do this. If you read Sylvia Brown's book, she says that the world will end in 2070. That's only 50 years from now, from toxic air and from loss of water and all sorts of things. Now, if you talk to the COP20, that says, 2050. Of course, by that time, 30 years from now, not 2020, I won't be around. I don't think most of us won't be around. And so, but if we don't do anything now, there won't be anything left for us. But nature doesn't care. Nature, human beings, you kill yourself, too bad. But we will, nature, we will regroup. We will grow and we'll change. In the whole world, we create the whole world again. So don't worry about nature. Nature doesn't care. What we're doing is to make sure the world continues. And the world continues is that we have to learn new things, we have to do new techniques, we have to do new ideas to help people do it. Now, that is my mission in life. Your mission in life is something else, you know. That's your business. But I'm doing this because I want to benefit humanity. I want to show things that I do that where people can change the built environment to become something that we want to be. That's my mission in life. Now, if you don't have a mission in life, then you're running around, you know, like a chicken without a head, you know. And I hope you're not doing that.
Dr. Yeang, thank you so much for sharing your mission in life. I know it's very inspirational for our students too. Yeah. I think this is an aspiration that, you know, many of us share with you. I know we're going over a little bit. I apologize a little bit. To end tonight's event, we want to say a big thank you to you.